talk. It ain't nothing but a thing. But a thing we want you to be tuned into every Saturday. This is Saturday, June the 11th, 2016. And this is our 18th show. Meaning that 117 shows ago, we started this journey called Veterans Talk. To bring the focus, the issues, and the plight of veterans. And to become a voice that can be heard throughout the veteran community. Good afternoon. Glad to have you here. Welcome. I'm Elsa McGee, your host. Today we got a very special guest who's no stranger to this stage, Bobby Rand, AMVEX National Service Officer. Brother, how you doing?
Okay, how are you doing today?
Glad to have you here again.
Okay, good to be
this
here.
Is one of the most knowledgeable brothers I know about the VA claim process and appeal process. And today, we're going to bring him into Camp Lejeune, which we know he's already there. We're going to be talking about the Camp Lejeune stuff, which we've been talking about for quite a few shows now, because it's the latest of the complications that we see at VA. It is a issue that is restricted primarily to some Marines and Navy guys who was at Camp Lejeune. The query with me is that it mimics, Bobby, so much of Agent Orange. Until this is, I've had claims that was deferred because I included the Camp Lejeune water contamination.
Yeah, those are handled at a, as the gentleman said, they're handled at the Kentucky or Louisville regional office. And what VA has done is they centralize all those claims to be processed in hope of getting them done faster. We're not seeing that.
Yeah, so. You know, one of the things that we see when Congress is involved, VA seem to do a lot of movement, but never get to a place that veterans can, you know, take it home to rest.
Correct. And one of the stumbling stones on that is because of the nature of the condition and trying to get a doctor to actually clarify it, and that, they're not telling the veterans that. Mm-hmm. Veterans are coming in, they're filing the claims, and then they're denying them because they're saying that nobody has said that the condition is related to that exposure.
And they're not telling the doctors to do it.
Correct.
You know, that's another case of veterans being caught between a rock and a hard place. But we are still marching on with this VA claim process and what is going on with the backlog, Bobby. Have you heard anything positive in relation to the backlog? They keep saying that it's coming down, but I'm not seeing any results of that in my caseload.
Well, I would tell you this, for every step you take forward, there's two going back, because there are a lot more claims coming into the system. Mm-hmm. Until they get enough people hired and qualified, mm-hmm. That's that key word, qualified
yeah.
To do the adjudication part of that, we're going to continue to see a backlog. But what we can do as veterans to assist in that is to what we call fully develop our claims, mm-hmm. before submitting them.
Exactly.
Because the more evidence, the more we build our case up prior to submitting them, the better our chances of getting them through in a timely manner. Mm-hmm. They talk about the disability benefit questionnaire, mm-hmm. getting that done prior to, but we're still fighting that battle on the fact that when we go through and we get that done, the Raiders are still sending the veterans out for an examination. Mm-hmm. So you're telling us on one hand, we get this documentation for you, you'll go ahead and send the claim through, but when we do that, your people are, well, the VA, is then turning around and sending the veteran out for a second
evaluation.
So it's one of the cases where we have to aggressively monitor those claims that we are submitting. Mm-hmm. When we see that they're attempting to do that, we have to step up and let them know, hey, this has already been diagnosed, the examination has already been done, we've given you a fully developed claim,
and they need to rate it.
Yes.
You know, and Bobby, that's one of the things that I've been, you know, doing in my clinics, is getting veterans to understand how critical it is to cooperate with the VA by submitting these fully developed claims. It just makes the process much faster.
Yes.
And it's less frustrating to me.
Yeah.
really, because I'm finding if I got all the evidence and I got my diagnosis, I got my cervical nucleus evidence, well, pretty much, you know, the VA is free to move.
Right. But I would say this, you know, for the veterans who are currently coming off active duty, there's not a big issue as far as the records. Mm-hmm. VA is going to accept those records as valid and process it. Mm-hmm. The issue comes into play is when veterans have been off of active duty for multiple years. Mm-hmm. And they normally don't have a copy of their records, because older veterans, when they came off of active duty, they weren't afforded that opportunity, although it is a law mm-hmm. that when they left active duty, they were supposed to be provided a copy of their medical records. So what I do, it takes a little longer, mm-hmm. but every veteran I represent, I make them go get their records from the National Personnel Center or from the VA, whichever one is holding on to those, because it's important, because developing a claim, you have to go back to the beginning, so to say. Mm-hmm. You got to find out what was in their service medical record, mm-hmm. what type of evidence is in there to support what they're filing for, mm-hmm. and then you have to build upon that.
Mm-hmm. So in most cases, I try to get that information in the C file from VA, but I'm going to tell you, in some cases, I find the C file be absence of the military service data. The record's not there.
Well, I can't speak truthfully on that. I can only speculate, because you have veterans who records get mixed up with other veterans. You get records where the person on active duty that's supposed to be in charge of transferring those records to the suppository in St. Louis mm-hmm. aren't doing it. Mm-hmm. And then you have the National Guard and the Reserves who maintain their records in a totally different manner. Mm-hmm. So trying to get all those records from those particular people is extremely hard. And the bottom line, when we enlist in the military, we're not sitting there thinking, I need to keep track of every piece of document mm-hmm. that covers my career. Mm-hmm. But until we start taking that responsibility ourselves mm-hmm. and educating people, veterans, young men, women, when they enlist in the military, while they're in, not after they leave, but before they even go in, they'll make them aware of the fact that you need to keep a separate copy of everything mm-hmm. that goes on with you while you're in the military. The other key part to that is, while you're on active duty, most doctors, military doctors, aren't in the business of diagnosing you. Mm-hmm. They're in the business of bandaging you and returning you to active duty. That is their main concern. Unless somebody's pushing that issue with that doctor while you're on active duty, they're not concerned about diagnosing mm-hmm. you.
You're not going to get a diagnosis.
Right. And when you then come in and file that claim with VA, that is what the regulations require them to have. Mm-hmm. Not that I'm not saying they don't want to give it to you, but their hands are tied too. Mm-hmm. The 38 CFR, which is written by Congress, mm-hmm. dictates them what standards must be met in order to grant the claim. Mm-hmm. So if we, on our side of the coin, prep everything before it gets to them, then we're giving them every opportunity to ensure that they're at least giving you a fair shake on it. Mm-hmm.
And Bobby, one of the things that I'm thinking a lot of guys not realize, and some of them, is that they need to be going to the doctor if they about to file a claim.
Yes.
You know, because even if they got the service connection, they could wind up with a zero rating.
Yes.
Could you talk about that a little bit for us?
Well,
I don't think I talk about it a lot, but
I'll say this. Say a veteran gets a rating of zero, or say a veteran gets a rating of 10%. Mm-hmm. And say there is a higher evaluation on that particular condition. Mm-hmm. The veteran gets a rating of, say, 2003. He goes from 2003 until 2006 and never sees a doctor. Mm-hmm. He believes in himself, because you know your own body. Mm-hmm. I know my own body. I know when things are not right. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to then file a claim in 2016. Haven't seen a doctor since 2013, mm-hmm. claiming for increase. Mm-hmm. And what VA is going to look at is at least the last 12 months, what medical evidence do you have to support your claim for that increase?
The increase.
And if you haven't seen a doctor and you have nothing you can produce to show that that condition has worsened, there's a likelihood that they're going to propose to reduce you then. And we are seeing that more and more that veterans are coming in, especially when it comes to mental condition. Because on mental conditions, they're projecting that particular veteran, if they haven't made them permanently and totally disabled, they're giving them a 5-year projection to come back in and review that particular condition. So over the 5-year period, if he hasn't seen a psychiatrist or a sociologist and he has no supporting evidence, they're going to propose to reduce him. Now they're going to say, we're going to give you 60 days to come in with evidence. Well, guess what? You can't even get an appointment with the VA in 60 days.
60 days, so that you're trapped.
So you're now stuck with between a rock and a hard place. Now they're proposing to reduce you. So now you're stressing. You now have to get medical documentation to prove why they should not reduce your benefits. And until VA receives that, they're going to reduce it. Now, in that process, there are steps you can take to stop them.
Stop the reduction.
But if they find in against you,
then you got to pay the money back.
Yeah. Then all that money that they would have taken, you now owe back to them.
Back to them.
So, you know, what do you do? Do you feel confident enough that you can get what you need from your doctor in order to get the documentation that you need to support that claim? But the education on this part is extremely important, because the verbiage and the letters coming out from the VA should explain all that. It doesn't.
Well, you know, Bobby, you know, taking that a little bit further to veterans' responsibility. Now, I get a lot of guys coming at you while they're trying to get you to file a claim and while the claim is filed. But once the claim is granted, they get well. They stop going to the doctors. You know, and this is not a reality to them. They think it's a reality. But if you look at their functionality in the homes, you know, I ask someone, well, they're waiting to die. You know, they do nothing. Because they are not better. They just don't want to go and encounter that stress and frustration of trying to be seen at VA. And I constantly tell guys, you need to stay in treatment, especially with mental disorders, because you could be suffering on your household.
Yes.
You know, and that's something that I constantly tell wives, I thank y'all for putting up with us. And they, you know, the guys look at me like I'm kind of crazy because they want to know what I'm talking about. I do their cases. So I know they're not doing better. They just stop going to the doctor because they got their 100%. And they are 100%. And their conduct in the household and their functionality in the community is 100%. You know, and that's a kind of sad thing, because we are needed. I think that all disabled veterans should be volunteering doing something. You know, so I want to applaud Dr. Cooper and what he's bringing to the table for opportunities for guys to stay active. You know, it's critical. I'm kind of one of those guys. My doctor, every time and I go see my doctor regular, you exercise. I put my cap down. But it's a serious business with veterans, especially in our age group, because when you start going down, if you are not in good shape, you're going to go down pretty fast.
Yes.
So we need to encourage guys, not just for your disability's sake, but for your family's sake. Stay in the doctor's care. You know, I admire those guys that say, man, I'm going to the doctor. I'm going to keep my doctor's appointment like I go vote.
Yes.
You know, and that's critical stuff. One of my members, Robert, is in the audience today, because Robert and I have a date with VA Monday. And Robert has a situation where it's pretty common, if you know how people exist over the years with VA. Robert has been a member of Vietnam Veterans of America since 2002, 2003. Been vice president, executive member. But he was one of those guys that were never in Vietnam, but was on the island of Okinawa. On the island of Okinawa, that they are piecemealing, you know,
right.
Now, day by day, they're going to finally get to recognize that the island ain't big as a shoebox and say, well, it was contaminated. It has nothing on it but a rock. So it's something been there that the United States is not really ready to just say that those guys that served in that Okinawa
were exposed.
Was exposed, yeah. And we know that they was exposed. Yeah. Well, he's got caught up in the confusion of service officers. He went to the VA some time back and was asking some questions, and they changed his service officer and filed a claim for him. But, you know, we kind of stopped some of that stuff, but we recognize now he got a hearing, and he got, another service officer who is telling him one thing, but has not given him evidence to support the claim. You know, I think it's critical for us when we are representing veterans that we at least tell them the truth. And if we're telling them something, we can show it to them in paper. We could actually show it to them. This is the red. This is what I'm basing my. Because it misleading a veteran to think that he can be service connected for something that there's no service nucleus in his evidence, and VA is not recognizing the presumptive, is critically wrong, because I think those disabilities are some of those things that's clogging up the process. We have a lot of people filing disabilities, and the veterans don't have the evidence to prove the disability.
Yeah, there's quite a few claims like that.
Yeah.
That's the one thing, as far as my organization, they give us the leeway to accept or deny representation.
Mm-hmm.
If a veteran comes to me, he wants to file a claim, he must then prove to me that he has the evidence to support that claim. Now, my job is to guide him through in obtaining that evidence, mm-hmm. not to just say, okay, go get the evidence and send them away and mm-hmm. I'm done with them.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm going to tell you what you're going to need. Mm-hmm. I'm going to explain how this process works.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to let them know that unless I feel within myself that there's enough evidence here that there's at least a 50-50 chance of you winning this case, I will not present it to VA.
I'm not going to file
now,
a claim. You know.
I get.
Can I interject?
Yeah.
I came here for exactly what you guys are speaking about. Elsa McGee is my representative. I follow every step he tells me, I move. And the last time me and you talked, you gave me a chamber representative
mm-hmm.
of form to care at the VA. Mm-hmm. I did. I got a letter in the mail not an hour ago saying that, now they took the information that you gave me,
mm-hmm.
kept it in the back, put a seal on it, brought it back and said, you good to go. The guy you want to represent you will represent you. I got a letter from the mayor today saying that you can't represent me because I didn't sign and date the document. But they took the document from me, hid it in the back. I never got a number, nothing. They hid it in the back and brought it back, called my name, Mr. Dixon, you good to go. I said, that's all I got to do. Yeah, you go home.
Well, I'll be your witness.
Well, and I will say this, and this is something I learned. I'm a retired Marine myself. When I first joined the Marine Corps, I had a wise gunny told me. He said, son, he said, every document that you ever turn to the S1, to medical, you make sure you get a copy of it.
Mm-hmm.
And the VA, when you turn in any document, are required to give you a document back, a copy of it, with that date stamp in it. Now, they may not have done it.
They did it. They gave me a copy.
They gave you a copy back. And is your copy completely filled?
They gave me a copy back today.
But is it completely filled out? And as they are saying that you...
Well, literally, I didn't fill out anything. Elson put the information on it. Told me to carry it to VA.
Because I'm going to tell you this, and this is the most frustrating thing for me, to be under the new guidelines on them approving or authorizing that 21-22. That's the form I believe we're talking about.
Yeah, 21-22.
I don't know whether they're getting guidance on this or what, but I'm getting more of those forms rejected because either a box wasn't checked or something wasn't completed fully.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times it just, I mean, the intent of that file is being misrepresented by VA. Because, you know, you have a box that's not checked, but what's stopping the veteran signed it,
mm-hmm.
everything else on his correct,
mm-hmm.
what's stopping me from representing this veteran? And they can't answer the question. They're just saying, okay, it isn't completely filled out. So then they send the file back to the veteran, and then they tell the veteran to send it to this or fax it or send it to this address. I never see that file or form again.
Mm-hmm.
So now mm-hmm. the file, we have no way of knowing where this form is now with the way they're working because everything goes to what they call centralized mailing. Well, that document is hung up somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a veteran who I can't completely represent because he did exactly what they told him to do.
Mm-hmm.
But because they haven't received it, it hasn't been uploaded,
mm-hmm.
I'm now restricted from access to that veteran's information.
Well,
so
and see, this is something that the VA Court of Veteran Appeals, in my case, overturned over 20 years ago, putting form over substance and deciding benefits. And this is exactly what you're talking about, Bobby. And that was what they did to me and had closed my case completely out. I had to go all the way through the regional office, all the way to the board, through the board to the board to the U.S. Court of Veterans Appeals. The court took my case. They reversed the case. Told the VA at that point, now, yeah, you put substance, I mean form over substance in trying to determine demand benefits. I was wounded in combat. They got all the records and everything was there. But because it was a, like you were saying, the form wasn't signed. It was put in, but it wasn't signed. I didn't know what to do. I just sent it in. And they denied me all the way up to the Court of Veterans Appeals, which is about a five-year process. And when I got back down to the VA, they gave me service connection. But that was like 5 years out of the box. So what we have to do is kind of stay straight up on that. Now, I have had situations happen like what Robert just bringing up now. And I just went in as a witness in the same hearing. So, you know, we still wind up in the room. It's just that, you know, and then we get there, there might be somebody up there at in the clerk level that we can talk to and they'll straighten this stuff out because they should have changed. So that's just
and a lot of times, I mean, I said you have, I always seem to be making excuses for VA, which I hate doing, because they get paid to do a job, and that's all we ask them to do is to do their job. But it seems like we have to go over their head or around them, because certain people just won't listen. And, you know, unfortunately, well, I don't know whether it's unfortunate or fortunate, we develop people in which we can go to in VA to get things done, who use common sense and processing the paperwork to allow us to do our job. But we shouldn't have to do that.
We shouldn't have to do that.
Every person in there that we come in contact should be able to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
But we are finding that's not always true.
That's not true.
I got this hearing coming up Monday.
Yeah.
I had a DAV representative that I hadn't heard from in over a year. And evidently notified her that I would have the hearing. She called me and told me, Mr. Dixon, I said, yes, I'm your DAV representative. I called to inform you that you will get paid for diabetes. You want to pay for your feet, your skin, or your knees, but you will get cervical connector for your diabetes. And you won't get paid for your finger on your left hand. I said, hold up. I said, are you sure you got my record? Mr. Dixon know all of me. I read 100 words a minute. I know what I'm talking about. And she told me where I was in Vietnam. I said, whoa, you're looking at the wrong record. Don't argue with me. I know what I'm talking about. And I can tell you the exact airborne unit you was in. I said, okay, which one was I in? You was in the 5th Division. I said, no, ma'am. I said, I was in the 173rd. And she said, what's your service? Do you remember your service number? I said, sure. UN5336673. Well, I get back with you. You know, she said, I've never had nothing wrong with my left hand. I never put boots on the ground in Vietnam. She said, she named the location where I was supposed to be in Vietnam. And I couldn't convince her that maybe you got my record mixed up with somebody else.
She probably have. We'll get there early enough to try to talk with her.
Well, she told me that I need to be there by 9.
Yeah, we'll get there early enough to talk.
Hearing is at 10.
See, the whole thing is sometimes the way Robert initially got his stuff changed, he went out to the VA making an inquiry, and they changed his service officer, filed a claim for him. They filed a PTSD claim for him then. We withdrew that one because he has no evidence of PTSD. So, you know, the thing I think that's really happening with shows like this is we're able to talk with veterans and able to talk with veteran service officers that want to straighten the VA up. See, a lot of people think I'm against the VA, but I'm for the VA. I want to see the VA function at a level that I know is capable of functioning at for veterans. You know, it is our agency. It was designed to deliver the benefits that we earned from our honorable service. It's our responsibility to help it make it work. One of the reasons Congress established VSOs was that we were to be partners with the VA and making sure veterans get their benefits. And that's basically what we're doing here today, is pointing out the shortfalls in that promise to veterans and trying to get veterans to understand that they can make it work. You know, Congress is very much open. Samson Bishop, this is Bruce Pogman, who is in Stanford Bishop's office and a personal friend of this congressman, that gets information and help us to understand how to get our congressmen involved, how to talk to the congressman. Because it's nothing wrong with you calling your congress and after identify your claim. You know, go to your congressman's office and talk to about the response you're getting from the VA if you feel like that claim has been filed too long, especially when you know it's been fully developed. You know, and most of my claims are filed fully developed claims because I think it helps. The VA does what it's supposed to be doing for the veteran that I'm representing. So this is Veterans Talk, y'all. You can call in 404-389-0916. You can join the conversation. You can talk with Bobby. You can raise a new issue. This is what we do to make sure that veterans have a voice. This is the official media voice for Vietnam Veterans of America, the Greater Atlanta Chapter, now with a new number. Chapter 1118 has assumed the responsibilities and the membership of Chapter 883, and we got a greater coverage area in Metro Atlanta. So you'll be hearing a lot from us next Saturday, 25th of June. We'll be at the historic Carver High School in our 16th annual celebration of grass with the Jazz on the Grass crew. We'll be giving out some more certificate of honors to about 45 Vietnam era veterans. And for the first time, we have on display the Atlanta Vietnam Wall Memorial Wall, meaning the 92 individuals that died from Atlanta, Georgia, will be on display at Carver High School. We are sorry, we apologize to all the high schools. Our effort was to actually try to identify what high schools that these guys came from. I can say, I can talk up for Lewis Herman, who was one of my best friends at Washington High School. His name is on that wall. So there are a lot of other people that gonna be coming from Carver, Price, Archer, Turner. You know, come look at the Atlanta, Georgia, Vietnam Wall, Memorial Wall. It's quite a sight to see. It's just a page off the Georgia Vietnam Wall, Memorial Wall, where all of the cities in the state of Georgia is listed, and the people that was from these cities are listed by town. You know, Georgia's a very small state, but very active military. 700,000 veterans in the state. Now, we gave pretty closely over 400 veterans to Vietnam War. So we are a proud veteran state. Now we are trying to make sure that veterans in this state come together to make sure that the VA become a more functional entity. Today we are here with Bobby Wren talking about the VA claim process. So if you have any questions, if you got any statements, you might have thought we said something wrong, or you think we didn't say something that you needed to hear, just call in 404-389-0916. Join the conversation. Bobby, one of the other things that I needed to put out, you know, being a part of the VSO Advisory Board has given us an opportunity to get information, you know, firsthand information about programs and things that are available for veterans at VA. Now, we know that VA Homeless Program had money to stop evictions. We know that for a fact, that they had money to stop eviction. Well, let me tell you, I had this young lady call my office about 3 weeks ago, and she had an eviction notice. You know, it was, you know, pretty late. She had about 4 or 5 days before they was gonna put her stuff on the street. Now, VA has money. They had money. I'm gonna say they had money. I called out and confirmed that the program was in existence. So I got the young lady and her 5-year-old and took them to VA Homeless Access Program.
Now, those are the people that had those grants. Okay, so let's make a distinction between the VA and the people who have those grants that were supposed to be assisting veterans who became homeless. And I believe that there was no accountability of those individuals who were receiving this money that was supposed to be sitting there for the betterment of the veterans in the community to assist them.
You tell them, just keep talking about it, because I didn't want to say it like that, but the money was gone.
Yes.
I took the young lady out to the VA. They told me to bring her back the next day. Somebody going to be there and write a check. Well, the next day we got there, the person showed up and they didn't have any money. And I found out then that was a grant program, that they had grant. And I got kind of really upset, because the first line of inquiry for most veterans are veteran service organizations. And I'm saying if there gonna be any grants given out to assist veterans at home, it should be veteran service organizations should be the first line of consideration in those areas. And people need to understand that. People don't go, they might call United Way. And United Way usually call my office or give my number up. And if they're talking about Vietnam era veterans, I know they give your number up if they talk. So I got really confused and really got out of whack with VA even signing off on a grant to somebody that's not a VSO. I mean, it don't make any sense to me. We are supposed to be the partners with VA to make sure that veterans are being serviced. And they send them to us, and they give the money to somebody else.
Well, I can't attest to who these people are and how I know how the process works. You got people who basically specialize in writing grants. Mm-hmm. That's all they do. Mm-hmm. So they come up with these schemes. Mm-hmm. I ain't going to call them nothing else but that scheme to get a grant. And there's no oversight once that money is issued to them.
Mm-hmm. No oversight.
So you're right.
That money was gone, man.
If that money was issued to a national service organization.
That had accountability.
Not only had accountability, but, you know, the news media, everybody would be in an uproar if we couldn't figure out where all that money went to.
Right.
And not that it lined our pockets. Mm-hmm. We have to, on a daily basis, produce evidence of what we're doing
with the money.
So why is there no oversight for these people who determine that they're going to now formulate a nonprofit to assist homeless veterans? And I shouldn't group all of them together because there probably are some good ones out there. I don't know where they are. There may be some good ones out there who are doing legitimate work in assisting veterans. But it seems like the only one we're hearing about is the one who get these grants, and we don't know where the money went, how the money was spent.
And they always come up with some scandalous position that reflects on us.
Right.
That's the bad part.
And I know that was brought up at the meeting, and what I heard from the VA, the power to be at the hospital, that they have no authority over those people.
Mm-hmm. Once they got
They're not the ones who grant the money.
But the money was granted in the name of helping veterans.
Yes.
And see, that's the problem that fly back in our face, Bobby, because we are established to help veterans, not to do business. You know, you got a lot of organizations out there, they are set up nonprofits to do business. Yeah. They're not there solely for the veteran itself, but to provide services. Yeah. And some of them are not providing the services that they're being paid to provide. And the side effect is that we are having a hard time doing away with homelessness because there's so much money in it, you know, they want to keep it going. You know, if we could just get some of that PDEA money out and get the barracks, as Bruce, come on, yeah, because I'm going
to
get up there.
Yeah, I just wanted to step in for just one moment. About almost a year ago, Congressman Stanford D. Bishop, Southern District State of Georgia, along with Brother McDonald, had a town hall meeting in Columbus, Georgia, at Fort Benning, Georgia's museum, infantry museum. While we were there, there were questions that came up, and they were saying about homeless veterans. And when I attempted to bring to them that Tuskegee VA, at one particular town, we first Vietnam veterans came through Tuskegee back in the late 80s. The PTS program that came together and Tuskegee VA was the PTSD program. They had at least 20 doctors over there. I went through the whole scene. Now, what I'm saying is that if you go to Tuskegee today, there's nobody. It's a ghost town. But those same buildings are still gas, electric, water.
Still on.
Hey, those 300 beds over there.
Still there.
Are still there, are not being used. Mm-hmm. The VA ain't come in and said, well, now we can break these up in sections. We can make this in there. So that way we can get a new transition going off these guys. You know, you don't have to be in the street. But when I began to introduce this, McDonald kind of ran on me, along with Dr. Orlis Fogel. Okay? So I'm trying to work with the congressman now to kind of introduce these things. But, you know, right now he's been kind of like really stretched out on this political trail. And they did pass Asian Orange, has a law now, and he was supportive of that. And so, as I stated, you know, we're putting forth all effort to reach out to our veterans, and you and I have spoke about Vietnam veterans who were state Marines that were up there in Camp Lejeune, went to Vietnam, and they come home, they got Asian Orange. Then the one that stayed in Camp Lejeune, went to Vietnam, came on PTSD. But when you relate the two together, the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. That's what we talked about, dual diagnosis.
Dual diagnosis.
Yes.
See, the one thing what got to happen, veterans have got to start joining DSOs. I mean, I just can't stress that enough. Every veteran should be a member of a VSO. And we got enough of them for every veteran to be a member of a VSO. And if we can get that going, first of all, we got too many veterans, and I got a bunch of them in my family that had not joined a VSO. It seems like to me, Bobby, I don't know what it is, they don't join until they have a crisis.
And the thing is, no matter which way we look at Congress and Senate, numbers play an important game.
The numbers.
And if you don't have the numbers, because I'll use this as an example. AMVETS is a small organization. DAV is a large organization. Every year at their national convention, they get the president. Mm-hmm. We get the deputy secretary because our numbers
don't warrant that
big of a presence of anybody to come see us. Mm-hmm. Now, should it be that way based on numbers? No. Mm-hmm. But until the numbers reflect and we as veterans start demonstrating, you know, look at the people who are demonstrating now. There are a lot more veterans than what we see out there. But if we were to come together as a group, we could elect the people we want. Going to support our agenda.
Exactly.
And even if we can't, the people who are elected, we got to hold their feet to the fire, mm-hmm. because they will be the first ones to pull the cameras up and have a veteran standing behind them with their cap on. Mm-hmm. But once that camera is off, I can't say all of them, because there are some out there who are truly dedicated to making sure veterans get everything they need. Mm-hmm. But once again, they're the few. And until they get the rest of that body on board on giving veterans what they deserve and have earned, and I always say earned, because there's no gift in any of this.
No.
These entitlements are earned by every veteran who puts on the uniform. So the political side of this, you know, until we come together and determine that we're going to do what we need to do, then we're going to get what we get.
Yeah. And you know, that's my whole position in writing up the Veteran Manifesto, the Power of Veterans with the ballot. Over 700,000 veterans in the state of Georgia. And I went into the poll in the last election in my district when I went to vote. It was 7 poll workers in there, and I was in 2 voters. I counted 13 incumbents on a poll. You know, so I looked at it, and I said, everybody's happy.
Yeah.
There's no discontent. You know, I'm going to the wrong groups. I need to be going to those groups that's not worried about nothing. Because people are not coming out representing that discontent in the ballot box. And that's the only way veterans are gonna get a VA that respects their benefits. See, you know, I sometimes see the sign VA benefits. VA don't have any benefits. They are veteran benefits that the VA are to deliver. I mean, the screening process, I think, has gotten out of hand sometime because it's becoming an adversary and antagonistic toward veterans' claims. But we see these things, but we are not joining the organizations, which will get organizations to work. And believe me, if you go up in Congress, you're going to see AMVETS, American Legion, DVA, all those people up there working together. But when it get down downtown, where boots on the ground, where you got to, you know, get in the trenches, it's a different story. We got to get that unity down here, Bruce.
Yeah, there was here back when President Bill Clinton was here. The Congressman arranged for us to have a meeting with him for a real short period, and I had a chance to tell him about toxic water exposure to Capitol Hill, and we talked a moment or two, and then he walked off to talk to someone else. He turned around and came back and said, "Get my aides over here, because I want to know more about this." I'm saying, like, it was on your watch, all this been going on. But you were not told. They're in the little black book. You didn't open it up, okay? In your little black book, it was Trump's war with Floyd Capital Jr. Now, then we had a chance to meet with her at City Hall, never mind. When we talked to her about it, they were just like, we don't know. We didn't know nothing about this. You know what I mean? I'm saying, hey guys, we have to get on the political bandwagon. And we have to give it all we well, let got, me say and this. We have to vote.
Let me say this, and Bobby pointed out good. You can get on that bandwagon, but you need to have some numbers with you. See, one of the things that veterans have, we got the numbers. In the state of Georgia, we got the numbers. And the reality is, we go to the poll and vote in the high 90s. But we're either voting
against
our own interests. We just voting party vote. We vote for Democrats or Republicans. And neither party has stood up specifically for us, but a few congressmen in each party have. So what we need to start doing is focusing our attention on those individuals, whether they're Democrats or Republicans, that stand up for veteran benefits and make sure that those people are elected and go throughout the community, making sure that we wake up people that can run for office, that can do what we want them to do. And if they don't, they will know that we voted you in, we'll vote you out. See, once they understand that, Democrat or Republican, we vote you in. You don't do what you're supposed to do for us, we're going to vote you out. And we'll make that a ground rule for us, because it breaks my heart when I fight for a veteran that got a claim pending and he dies before that claim is completed. You know, it breaks my heart because his surviving spouse might not get anything. There's a real possibility. I've got cases going on right now where I just found a lawyer for one of them. But one, 30 years in the process, still ain't got no relief. All the information that she needed to get the relief is in the brother's file. He was diagnosed with peptic ulcers in the military, and he died with peptic ulcers after the military. The VA looked at his record saying that he had stomach problems in the military, he had stomach problems out of the military, and he was diagnosed with peptic ulcers before he died. But since there was no diagnosis of the peptic ulcers in his records, the doctor saying it's more likely than not that it causing that. But then it was a piece of paper in the man file that they didn't show the doctors that showed he was diagnosed with peptic ulcers in the military. So, and the VA always split halves. David Case went up last week. They called him yesterday. He had to rush out to the VA. I thought they was dealing with the aid and attendance care. They had found something in his record. They finna cut his check off for this month, because he hadn't filled something up that went to the VA since he was on Rogers Avenue. So they started looking through his records. They worked on this case, and they found something. They was going to cut his check off. Hadn't it been for Ursula, she stopped that. I got to give her that. She saw it, email me. I told Dave, I said, Dave, they trying to get in touch with you. Well, ain't that well. They got in early day morning, told him to get out to the VA. They signed some paper that he hadn't signed since 2011. And they were going to use it to cut his check off. They were going to take his check this month. But it just so happened, Ursula had my number, and she had his stuff. I had gave to her. She emailed me, and that stopped it. But like you say, Bob, we shouldn't have to go through that. We shouldn't have to have special favors. Veterans should be protected across the board. But I know right now that there are a lot of people being reduced and don't know what to do. There are a lot of people that's being denied and they don't know what to do. Well, today you had one of the best shows and the best opportunities to connect with AMVEX and Vietnam Veterans of America. I think two of the organizations that I know that are representing veterans every day at VA and in this country. We didn't get one call, but I bet you Bobby gonna get some calls, and I'm gonna get some calls in our office asking questions about what we talked about today. So veterans gonna have to make Saturday evening their evening to get information. So when Monday comes, they'll know what to do at VA. I want to thank everybody for showing up, Edwina. Little Bruce, thank you for coming with your dad. You know, just keep him straight. You know, we need to keep him in the walk. Keep him in the fight. And Robert, you know, Monday morning, we're going to show up. We don't care what they say. You know, we know what the paperwork do. And we know when we get out there, they're going to let us in the room. I want to know if you get that certificate for diabetes, though. I've been trying to get you serious looking for diabetes. And I know I got to get Okinawa records first. I'm saying that she got Okinawa records. If she got Okinawa records, yeah, we need her there. See, that's another thing. Service reps got to start working together. I mean, that's because a lot of times we don't understand. When a veteran appear at the VA, he got a question. He don't necessarily want to change his service officer. But, you know.
I represent them or not.
Yeah.
I actually have a veteran coming in Tuesday who I don't represent. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to say who does, but he's from the
say, okay, you don't necessarily need to change service officers. I work with your service officer. I ain't got no problem with working with another organization because we are all working for the same thing.